Penguin Random House Canada presents The Certainties by Aislinn Hunter. Read for you by Steve Cumyn and Sandra Flores. For Glenn, always. Narcissus, my sorrow, and the likeness of my sorrow. Federico Garcia Lorca. Go now, beside the uncertainties. In black veils stand the certainties. Dermot Healy. I stand on my hotel balcony and look to the sea and to the sky's unbridled light. On the beach below, the gulls thrash and squawk. A vagrant scrounges for cigarette stubs. As I watch him, the same thought circles. When we are dead, we will not know our nations. The vagrant crouches in his baggy trousers, sweeps the pebbles with the side of his hand, and pockets what he finds there. His hair is thin and patchy, and he scratches at it frequently. For an hour, I've watched him tread barefoot back and forth across the short stretch of beach. His feet have given me ample pause, as I've been up since dawn trying to decide if I'd prefer to die with my shoes on or off. Sometime around 7, the hotel keeper dropped a breakfast tray outside my door. I can imagine the ants I saw on the ground floor of the hotel tipping their antennae toward the heel of bread and drizzle of oil. The old woman is long past apologizing for the weak tea or the size of the rations. Her sort is one we keep encountering, weary of us, of what trouble we might bring, even as she stuffs the crumpled pesetas we give her into a tin. The breeze coming in off the sea is warm and fresh. Already in the morning light, a man and a woman with skin still sun-kissed from summer wade out into the bay. She's wearing a bright yellow swimming costume, her dark hair tied in a plait. Beyond them, a sailboat lolls gently in the harbor as if the world were not in tatters, as if this were simply another September day. Further out again, past the twin points of the headland, a merchant ship steams south, heading toward Barcelona or perhaps as far as Tangiers. My death in front of me as I stand here, as palpable as that boat cutting through the water. Yesterday afternoon, before my companions and I were placed under detention, I walked along the Passage de la Sardana to a restaurant called Paradou. There's a wine I'm fond of, a hearty red by a Bordeaux vintner, and I was, if I'm being truthful, looking for something close enough to transport me back to better days in Paris. This wine was one I would drink with my friends from the philosophy department when we met at the café in Saint-Germain. The five of us under the café's striped awning arguing causality or perception as if we were closing in on problems that could be solved. It was 1:45 when I set out from the hotel, turning right onto the passage. The street and the beach were quiet. A man in a clerk's uniform passed me without meeting my eye, and then a couple overtook me, heading toward the pier. The old men occupying the shaded benches that faced the sea kept their eyes on the boats that had been pulled up above the tide line and did not turn to watch me. The buildings I passed under were weather-worn and pitted by bullets or gouged by bombs. There was a hole in the street which a woman casually walked around. Coming off the mountain the previous evening, we'd passed by worse damage near the train station. The face of a church reduced to rubble, the remains of a house slumped between crumbling apartments. Compared to the three Spanish restaurants I passed on my way to the Paradou, places with washed canopies and clean tablecloths, a few customers on their terraces, the Paradou was desolate. At La Dorada, the tables lined up under the plantain trees each had a vase of bright red peonies in their center. How absurd, I thought, that people were still growing flowers, that flowers still willed themselves to bloom. Unlike La Dorada, the Paradou's courtyard, was gloomy and sour-smelling. There were rivulets of water running down the cobblestones as if someone had sloshed a bucket at the source of the stench and then given up. There was no one outside, so I had my choice of the 10 tables enclosed within its thin railing and chose the one closest to the beach so that the mineral lilt of the sea was before me. While I waited for the server, I watched a terrier pacing along the water. He was the kind of dog my sister had come to favor in her married life, and which, for no reason I could identify, I despised. Ritter was Mira's last dog, a chaser, bred for ratting, made into a pet, and killed in an accident beneath the wheel of a butcher's cart. I have always believed that if one wants to engage with an animal, one must do so on the animal's terms, not demean him through an excess of coddling. Mira was the opposite, even had a special cushion for the dog, which she placed under the pearwood table in the drawing room. How her guests laughed at that the summer I stayed with Mira in Durbach. Those dogs who seem closest to wolves are the ones who interest me the most. What breed was Salome's pet? A wolfhound? Always slinking around the studio and once baring her teeth at Andre when he blustered in drunkenly. I had been sitting on the chaise by the window and remember thinking, a bit too admiringly, that she'd tear Andre's throat right out of his neck if he weren't careful. The table I chose had croissant flakes on it and a spot of jam. When the waiter did not arrive with a cloth, I wiped the crumbs away with my hand and turned the table slightly to move the daub of jam to the side. It was nearing 1 o'clock, and more people were moving along the passage. A grape picker in his wide-brimmed hat, 2 men I took to be civil servants, a man in a railway worker's uniform who was likely heading home for his midday meal. None of them glanced at me, though I sensed they were all well aware of my presence. After a lull, a smartly dressed man in a black suit and Homburg came along. Another marvel, that the market economy still flowed, that the man's suit showed little sign of wear, even though production of goods was faltering and decent clothing had ceased to be affordable. This man gazed over at me. He had thick brows, a prominent nose, and a soft chin that made him appear sympathetic. He nodded the slightest bit as he passed my table and then proceeded up a stony pathway toward the hem of the mountain, where 3 houses stood along a terraced ridge. The house closest to the passage, the one the man entered, was yellow, and though it was dilapidated like so many of the other houses in the village, it had a kind of regal facade, and what I imagined would be a magnificent view of the sea from its upper windows. To the side of the house, behind a low wall, a woman was pegging clothes onto a laundry line. In an attempt to quell my impatience over the absent waiter, I studied her efficiency and the graceful reach of her arms. As I watched her, the row of men's shirts and women's blouses grew. Just when I was thinking I should get up and leave, a trio of hens appeared a little ways up the mount, clucking and squawking loudly and darting around a gate. These 3 hens were soon joined by 2 more, who seemed to have escaped along a similar route. A flustered woman in a plain black dress followed soon after, reaching down to grab first 1 hen, then the other, with no success. She kept at them, though, rushing here and there, trying to pluck them up or bustle them back into the yard. Such clucking frustration on the hen's part. Just when they discovered the larger world of Port Beau. One notices the strangest things in these years. How the woman chasing her hens, a middle-aged woman with a blue scarf tied around her neck, would, once, have been laughing. Laughter that would draw someone else, perhaps a neighbor or the absent waiter I was trying not to be preoccupied with, to help. I imagined the waiter swishing his apron to move the hens along. The woman and the waiter would know each other, at any rate. There would likely be a measure of trust between them. But now the woman looked frightened. Seeing her worried expression, I entertained the idea of getting up to help her myself, but that would have been a joke. I'm 50 years old, and my left leg is so stiff in the morning I have to set my jaw to the task of moving with any haste. This is not, as my traveling companions believe, the result of the strain of the journey. It's a simple hobbling. Age and exhaustion. A weak heart. My infirmity was the inspiration behind the insult delivered by my sister 6 months ago in my apartment in Paris when, frustrated by the futility of her attempt to coax me into going into exile.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.